Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Washington Latin's virtual open house. We are grateful that you are all here with us tonight. As you see, there were some behind the scenes things to get used to doing things virtually again. We were fortunate enough to have an in-person open house last month. So we're very happy that you can join us virtually and safely this month. So just give you a quick rundown for the night. You're going to hear from Peter Anderson, our head of school. Then you'll hear from Jimmy Kelly, our principal. And then you'll hear from Joe Starnes, one of our alums, and he's also our fifth grade Latin teacher. And then you will hear from Ella Hankins, who's in 10th grade class of 2024. Then you'll hear from Jennifer Thorpe Lewis, who's our PFA vice president and also a parent of two amazing young men at Washington Latin. And then you'll hear from me again. I'm sorry. Then you'll hear from Mr. Anderson again about our second campus, which is called the Cooper campus. And then you'll hear from me about the admission process and what that will look like this year. So again, thank you for joining us and we will get started. Mr. Anderson.
I'm sorry, I was on mute because there is an ambulance that is driving past the school and I didn't want the siren to be on as a part of the webinar. Good evening, everyone. And welcome, and just add my welcome to the one you heard from Ms. Ella Biel. I have the good fortune of being Washington Latin's head of school. I'm in my sixth year. And to give you a sense of what it means to be head of school, Washington Latin is like a little mini school district. We use the term LEA, which is Local Education Agency, which is a really fancy term to talk about, sort of a self-contained mini district. And my role is like that of a superintendent within the district. You'll hear from Mr. Kelly later on, who is the principal of our current campus and here at Second Street. And I'll be speaking a little bit later on about an additional campus that we'll be adding to our district come the summer. But for right now, you should know that I work very closely with Mr. Kelly in the administration of our current school, but a lot of what I do is outward facing. So working with our board, working with donors to get to support the school, working with policymakers and politicians and city officials on a variety of different issues. And I wanted to start by talking about who we are as a school. And there is a really diverse education landscape in Washington, DC. We've got a wide variety of schools, Montessori schools, language emergent schools. We've got expeditionary learning schools. There are quite a number of them. But there's only one classical school. And I'll explain what we mean by that in a moment. But we're also a school that's very much defined by our mission. And you'll see that the mission is displayed on the screen. Our founders, 16 years ago, wanted to provide a unique opportunity to young people in the city of Washington, DC, deliberately trying to provide this program to kids from all across the city. And that's why we talk about it being accessible throughout the District of Columbia. And we have these really powerful statements, I believe. You'll see at the bottom of the screen, ours is a school where words matter, ideas matter, and people matter. We take that very seriously, and you'll see some evidence of that in some of the slides that will follow this one. Let's go to the next one. Next slide, please. Okay. So when we talk about a classical education, we're really talking about a form of education that used to be quite common in this country. Public education was founded on the classical tenets, which means that we study the language, the literature, the history, the philosophy of the ancient world, primarily Roman and Greece. Not exclusively, but primarily. And where we have a number of concepts that drive how we operate. We believe very much in embracing concepts of truth, beauty, and goodness. We're very much trying to educate young people into a fuller humanity. I'll say more about that in a moment. But this form of education, this model, this classical model, which was once so common, started to become displaced probably around the turn of the last century, where now it's not common at all. In fact, we're the only school in Washington, D.C. that offers a fully classical model. Next slide. Part of being a classical school is that we offer Latin to our students, the Latin language. And it's in our name, but it's also part of what we offer to students. So all students take Latin. They begin, if they start with us in middle school, they begin to take high school credited courses in Latin, beginning as early as seventh grade. But besides, and if students want to continue beyond Latin 3, which if they begin with us in middle school, would terminate in ninth grade. If they continue in the language, they could eventually even study ancient Greek, which is sort of at the end of the classical language study. Next slide, please. Besides the study of the language of the ancient world, we also use some of the pedagogical methods of the ancient world. So any of you are probably familiar with the Socratic method. And the Socratic method is a very much discussion-oriented approach to learning. And that is an integral part of every course, whether we're teaching an English course, teaching a math course, or even teaching a PE or a health course. Next slide. What was sort of central to the classical approach is, like I said before, ideas matter. And in developing ideas, we develop them through reasoned civil debate. Students are taught to develop opinions that are informed, that are reasoned, but also that are flexible. We want kids to not necessarily be dogmatic in their beliefs and in their opinions, but to be open to having their minds changed. And this happens in the exchange of ideas with other students and with adults who are part of our community. Next slide. Part of what we are trying to do in our program is develop autonomous young people. And that word autonomous simply means self-governing. And so self-governance and self-discipline are both critical to our model and our central goals at LAP. Next slide. Besides Latin and Greek, we offer a number of world languages, and students who take more than the minimum, everyone's required to take at least 2 years of world languages. If they venture into that third or fourth year or beyond of that world language, they have the opportunity to participate in one of our language-based overseas trips. Obviously, we didn't have any of those trips last year or even the year before because they happened during spring break, but we're hoping that we will return to overseas travel quickly. It's one of the things that I think has been a hallmark of our program over the years. And at this point, Mr. Kelly will talk a little bit more about what school is like at Washington 11.
All right, good evening, families. Sad that we don't get to see you, not even in your little tiles on Zoom, but very grateful that you're here with us this evening, and I have the great pleasure of sharing a little bit more about Washington Latin. Mrs. Cromwell, can you move the next slide, please? So first, at Latin, we believe that it is important for all of our students to be known. We are a small school. Our average class size in the middle school is 19. Our average class size in the high school is about 15. This is a small environment where students get to know one another and where their teachers get to know them. So here's a picture of some of our fifth graders entering the building with Mr. E. In obviously pre-COVID times, you don't see any masks. Mr. E is one of our incredible deans, and it's a great shot from one of our morning routines. Next slide, Ms. Cromwell. All right, we start each day with advisory and we build community. And advisory is one of the ways we build community at Washington Latin. Parents, you're all familiar perhaps with the idea of a homeroom. You go to homeroom, you get your attendance taken, you may receive early announcements. Those things happen in advisory each morning. But beyond that, advisory is a space that is meant to be our first home at Washington Latin. Every week we gather with our advisories and we have an advisory lunch. We break bread, one of the most natural ways we build bonds with other people. And so once a week, the advisory comes together, they eat lunch together, they often have potlucks, and it's a time for students to get to know one another in a setting that is outside of their academic setting, but in a space where they can learn and grow together. So that's an essential part of our model. Next slide. I mentioned the small class sizes. This really is about allowing teachers to have the time to get to know their students individually and to be able to provide them individualized and personalized attention. So here's a shot from one of our upper school classrooms. Thank you, Ms. Cromwell. Next slide. All right. One important thing about our school is that while our school day ends at 3:15 most days, we really believe it's important for students to have extra opportunities to meet with their teachers. And so in some schools, teachers schedule one-off appointments with students to work with them. At our school, our tutorial is an extension of the day that all the teachers do 4 days a week. So when the school day ends, we have an additional half hour of time where students can come drop in and meet with a student to get some extra help, to do some more practice, to work one-on-one on something that they're working through, to talk, chat. It's a time for connection. And so our program believes that these open office hours essentially are an essential part of our academic model. And that's what extends into the evening each day. Thank you, Ms. Cromwell. All right, liberal arts. You heard Mr. Anderson talk about classical education earlier. So part of liberal arts is the idea that our students should learn, of course, the fundamentals. They should learn reading and math. But beyond that, they should have an equal amount of time in science, history, Latin. And at Washington Latin, we also believe deeply in the arts. And so in every year of study, students have an opportunity to take classes in the arts as an extension of the curriculum. And it's actually not just an extension, but really core to who we are. Next slide, please. I mentioned science earlier, and folks think about us as a classical school and they assume that maybe we're just focused on English, we're just focused on reading, we're just focused on the concepts of the liberal arts in that sense, but we're also a very strong science and math school. So here is pictured from a couple of years ago, pre-pandemic, some of our seniors presenting their research. They conducted independent research projects across an entire year, and they presented their research to their peers and to faculty. I also want to mention in this slide, because math is really important to me, that every administrator at Washington Latin teaches. And so I actually teach a class of honors geometry to 8th and 9th graders. So math represents here as well. Thank you, Ms. Cromwell. Next slide. All right. We also believe that it's really important for young people to have space to go out and to have time to stretch. We believe that a healthy mind comes from a healthy body. So we have recess every day. Yes, even in the high school, our students have time to step away from their academic subjects and have break. We also have an extensive offering of team sports. We had basketball tryouts in the evening this today, and our fall sports season has just ended with several championship teams. Some of them are continuing into the playoffs this week. Lots of offerings, and we'll share more about that on the next slide. All right. Team athletics begin in 6th grade, and we offer more than a dozen options for both middle and high school students, competitive and non-competitive options. So if your student wants to be part of a competitive team, awesome. They can go out and try out for one of those competitive teams. But we do have non-competitive options for all students, things like yoga and conditioning. We've offered self-defense in the past. And what you see here is our high school wrestling team, which is actually a co-ed team, which is really a fun aspect of what we do. So just to give you a little bit of a look into the variety of the sports that we offer. Next slide, Ms. Cromwell. All right. And I mentioned the arts earlier. So theater is an important element of the classical model. It's a space where we learn how to speak publicly. It's a place where we can bring our creativity. So theater is actually a required class for 5th and 6th graders. And we also have a range of student performances in theater. Two productions every year. And those productions, as you can see in this photo, you see the tall students up front and the shorter students in the back. We have students from 5th through 12th grade that participate in these productions together. We also have an incredible musical program. They're actually setting up right now. In 8 minutes, they're going to launch their fall concert with a jazz band and several choirs presenting this evening. All right. And I think we can go on to the next slide, Ms. Cromwell. So we do draw from all 8 wards of the city. And so want to highlight the fact that we offer school buses to several neighborhoods across the city. We do change those offerings periodically based on where our families are located, but want you to know that we have bus service available to different parts of the city. Next slide. We also offer aftercare in the middle school. So the younger middle school students have options after school to stay as late as 6 p.m. And students and families are welcome to sign up to join aftercare. There are also an abundance, as you've already started to see, of other options that are available to students after school. We are not a school that shuts down at 3:15 or 3:45. We have lots of evening life as we do today. Next slide. All right, and with that, I get the privilege of introducing Mr. Starnes, who is a Latin alumni who has come back and is part of our faculty. He teaches fifth grade Latin, and here you can see him from a couple of years ago on an what might have been an advisory lunch day, but going through and getting lunch. So Mr. Starnes, I'm going to pass it over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly. Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us this evening. My name is Joe Starnes. I attended Washington Latin from 2006 to 2013. My time here at the school as a student was really foundational and formative, at least for me. And it's part of the reason why I came back is because I feel this weird but awesome loyalty and bond with the school that I can't seem to shake. And it's not that I'm trying to shake it, but it's just been a privilege to come back and to give back to the community that helped shape the person that I am today. As a student, Latin looked very different back then. We had no buildings. My parents took a chance on this classical curriculum that they knew very little about. And I'm sure some of you might be a little hesitant to put your kids into something that you don't know very much about. But I can tell you that it opened many doors for me. It helped me learn how to discuss ideas with my classmates, how to discuss ideas with adults in the room. There's a lot of talk about, preparing kids for college, but I think that this school significantly helped me in that regard. And coming back as a teacher, things are very different. I was never in this building that we're in right now. And teaching in the space that I've never been, I think helped me professionally in order to separate, student life from teacher life. But also the thing that stayed was the culture of the school. What keeps bringing me back every year are the relationships that I form with my students and the relationships that I see my students form with other teachers in the building. And I think that's what the core of this school is really finding an adult that you trust, not being afraid to take risks with those adults, and learning how to be a decent and kind human being, and one that really emphasizes the importance of education. And I'm just eternally grateful to be here at Latin. I teach fifth grade, so I get the students right when they first enter, and I think that that's a really important stage in a student's life here at Washington Latin is their first year. I think that it can make or break their experience. And I'm really grateful for the opportunity to be able to introduce your children to this amazing school that has served me so well throughout my entire life. Since I was 11 years old, all I've known is Washington Latin, save a 4-year break for college. But it's been an honor, and I really do hope that you choose Washington Latin, as I think that your children will be better for it. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Starnes. I now have the great privilege of presenting to you one of our students. And I mentioned to you earlier that I have the privilege as principal to also teach. And Ella Hankins, who I'm going to introduce in just a second, is one of my former students. She was in my eighth grade geometry class 2 years ago. Ella is now a 10th grader. She's a member of the class of 2024. And as a 10th grader, she is also the editor-in-chief of our school newspaper, which is just pretty darn incredible. And Ella and I were corresponding earlier this evening because they are getting their November edition ready to send out to the presses. So Ella, without further ado, I'll let you share your reflections with the families that are with us tonight.
Thank you. As Mr. Kelly said, my name is Ella Hankins and I'm a 10th grader. I've been a member of the Washington Lion community since fifth grade. And as I am here today, I feel so grateful for all the opportunities and support that the school has provided me. However, that is not how I've always felt. 6 years ago, I was in the same situation you are in now, sitting in the audience of Washington Latin's open house. At the end of the open house, I was so excited and hopeful that I would get to attend the school. But by the time I got off the wait list in the beginning of the next school year, I didn't want to leave my old school and all the friends I'd known since pre-K. When I got home after my first day at Washington Latin and told my mother in tears that I wanted to go back to my elementary school, she said that I could not truly get an experience by attending for just one day and that I needed to go back, and so we made a deal. I would go to the school every day, and if I still wanted to return to my neighborhood elementary school at the start of winter break, then I could. For the first couple of days, the deal was all that kept me going, but then it got better. I started to learn people's names and made friends and became invested in my classes. So by the time winter break came around, there was no question I was staying at Washington Latin. By staying, I was able to experience so many amazing opportunities that I would not have had I gone to a bigger school like the ones in my neighborhood. In fifth grade, students vote on a song and then after lots of practice and help from the theater teacher, do a flash mob performance for the sixth grade class. In sixth grade, my civics class created shields modeled after those used by the ancient Greeks. And then we went out on the field and charged at my teacher in a phalanx position. In my seventh grade English class, we read To Kill a Mockingbird and took a day trip to New York to see the play version on Broadway. Seventh grade is also the year when students go to Echo Hill and we all spend a couple days in the outdoors bonding and having great food. In eighth grade, I was able to take a geometry class, like Mr. Kelly mentioned, meant for high schoolers, along with some of my friends who had also shown strong math abilities. It was challenging at first, but it became fun as we all worked through the units together and bonded over the hard work required. And in ninth grade, my government class simulated the process of creating a government by splitting up into groups and rebuilding Washington, D.C. after a zombie apocalypse. When the pandemic took over the world, I spent the end of middle school and most of my ninth grade year inside my own house. As awful as quarantine was, this was when Washington Latin really shined. The faculty and staff put in a tremendous amount of effort to make remote learning accessible and helpful to all. My classes were not slowed down or oversimplified because of remote learning, allowing me to learn at a proper level. The school also incorporated mental health breaks, referred to as Wellness Wednesdays, and other chances to prevent all of us from losing our minds during quarantine. And this is just one example of a common thread woven through my time at Latin. From administrators to teachers to students, we all look out for and support each other. When one of my teachers noticed I was feeling overwhelmed, he guided me towards one of the counselors who took the time to listen to me until I felt better. When I was diagnosed with a learning disability and needed to create a 504 plan last year, the school worked with my mother and me to make sure that every little detail matched what was ideal for me. And one time, I walked into the girls' bathroom to find a classmate crying. I walked up to her in order to provide comfort, and seconds later, more girls entered and did the same. Soon we were laughing and joking around with each other, the sadness forgotten. Moments like these are why I love attending this school, because I know that if I hit a bump in the road, others will be there to help me. This year, I'm trying to keep my head on straight, despite the stress that comes with high school, but I'm enjoying my classes, especially AP Statistics and AP Language and Composition, and I love the extracurricular activities I'm a part of, including being editor of the school newspaper, the co-leader of Black Lives Matter Club, and a member of the Girls Leading Our World Club, and the set painter for the school musical. I'll be hanging around for a while, so if you have any questions, whether you're a student or a parent, feel free to ask them in the chat. I'd be happy to answer all of them to the best of my ability. Thank you so much for listening to me speak, and I hope you are inspired tonight to enter the lottery.
Thank you, Ella. Next up, you're going to hear from Jennifer Thorpe Lewis, who is our vice president of the PFA, which is our Parent Faculty Association, as well as a mom of two young men at Washington Latin. So the floor is yours, Jennifer.
Thank you. Thank you. Welcome, everyone. And like Mr. Kelly said, it's a shame that we can't see your faces. But I just want to applaud and accentuate everything that Ella just mentioned, and I wanted to reiterate to you all that the way I would describe the Latin community is community collaboration, family focused. I want to highlight three particular groups of people, and actually the people, the adults in these groups, they overlap, they take on multiple roles. The first is the advisors. You heard them talk about the advisors for the students, but guess what, families? The advisors are there for you too. You partner with them to develop your child, your student, your scholar, the whole child. And that's a wonderful thing. Homeroom teachers have an accentuated role as advisors at Washington Latin. And that was one of the things that was most special to me as I reviewed the school many years ago, 7 to be exact, when my first child join the lottery to attend Latin. The other group of people I call the go-to people. These are people that the students have a special connection with, similar to, as Ella was saying, someone who noticed her her countenance was different and had a special connection with her to say, hey, how are things going? And then pursuing that so that they can make sure that her experience at Latin is the most rewarding and beneficial for her. Again, guess what, parents? We encourage family members, parents, guardians to have go-to people within the school also. Those people for you provide the same kind of thing. You can go to them to get a little bit more insight on how things are going, how things work at the school, and it's highly encouraged. The third and final group is a much larger group, but again, a lot of these adults take on multiple roles, and that is the Parent Faculty Association. Very similar to your PTA, but very different. It is emphasized, it's the parents, it's made up of parents, 8 parents as grade reps, 4 parents as officers, faculty, 2 faculty members, serve in the role as a liaison and guidance and focal point. And then I think the most special part about it is the administration. We have the director of advocacy, communications and engagement, parent communications and engagement, Ms. Cromwell. She is the administration's point of contact, and she is our point of contact. So it is a tremendous collaboration that the PFA does for the care and feeding of our scholars, the care and feeding of the scholars' families. We fundraise, we community build, we do information sharing. So if you are lucky enough to join us, you will be more than you'll be more than happy to be a part of our community. Not only will your children be seen, heard, known, and valued, but so will you. So I wish you luck and hope to see you on campus. Thank you.
So thank you, Mr. Lewis. So everyone, Ms. Cromwell had to go because her son is playing in the concert actually tonight. So I was having an issue before starting sharing my screen. So just bear with me. I think I have it, but you're just going to see, just give me 1 second and I'm going to start sharing.
While Ms. Elabiel is transitioning to the next slide, I can actually get started. Yeah, just go to the next one, Ms. Elabiel, you're good. There we go. So as I mentioned earlier, we are growing as an LEA. And, you know, this is my sixth year. Prior to coming to Washington Latin, I had been working in New York City. And when I was recruited to come to DC, one of the things I was told is that the school was considering expanding and adding a second school, another school to the one that we have right here at Second Street. And after a lot of deliberation and planning and fits and starts, we are ready to open that second campus. We're opening it at 711 Edgewood Street, Northeast in Ward 5. That is going to be the temporary home for the second campus. And I say temporary home because we're only going to be there for at most 3 years. And that's very similar to the beginning of this current school. We actually began in less auspicious digs, as it were, starting in some church basements and going from church basement to church basement for a few years until we were, and even going into spending part of our time in a house before we were able to secure this facility, which we're extremely happy that we're in and proud of. This second campus is going to begin with fifth and sixth grade sections. We're planning to start with about 60 fifth graders and about 95 sixth graders next year. And then we'll grow from that point forward each year thereafter until we have grades 5 through 12, similar to what we have here. It'll be a separate school with its own principal. If you're interested in this campus and that campus, you are welcome to apply to both. You'll have opportunities to put down 2 Washington Latin campuses on the lottery, and we'll increase your chance. Next year will be the sort of the best opportunity for families looking for a Washington Latin education, because it will be the year when we have the most openings that we've ever had. We'll have 95 here on this campus. We'll have in fifth grade, we'll have, as I said, another 60. At that campus in fifth grade, and then 95 in sixth grade, which we've never had that many openings for sixth grade in 1 year. So that is exciting. And those will be the primary points of entry. We'll have you know, a handful of openings in grade 6 through 8 at this campus, and then a handful of openings also in ninth grade. The name of that second campus is Washington Latin Public Charter School, the Anna Julia Cooper campus. And this slide says our plan is to name this campus in honor of Dr. Cooper. And that is because the name and the site have to be officially approved by the DC Public Charter School Board, which cannot happen before January of 2022. But we have no doubt that they will approve that name and approve that site. Dr. Cooper was a champion for civil rights. She advocated on behalf of women and the poor. And she earned a PhD in philosophy from the Sorbonne when she was in her 60s. She was an educator here in DC. She was actually the principal of a school that eventually became Dunbar High School here in DC. And I did notice in the chat, would we consider opening a site, a campus in Southeast? When we were looking for a second campus, we were not looking in a particular location. Our biggest criteria was that it would be accessible to public transportation and easy for kids from across the city to be able to get to. We have this space in Ward 5 for the next 3 years, and thereafter, we're not sure where the permanent home will be, and we're open to other parts of the city, not just Ward 5. And as far as, we don't have a specific location in mind. We're looking wherever we can find space. And I have literally been looking along with my team for space for 4 years. And it's not easy to find space that can accommodate the full program. So as this slide shows, there'll be two campuses and three schools in My School DC. The reason why it says three schools is that My School DC, the DC Public Charter School Board, OSSE, all of those agencies, all consider this campus that we have here at Second Street to house two schools, a middle school and a high school. Obviously, after eighth grade, kids who stay at Washington Latin just continue automatically to the ninth grade. They don't have to apply separately. But in the lottery, for those who are outside of the school community, we are considered to be two schools. And then as of next year, we'll be two campuses and three schools. And so you can find all of the information when the lottery opens next month. And I think that is it. So
there's one more slide, Mr. Anderson.
I think that's for you.
Yep, for key dates coming up. So December 11th will, as you can see, will be EdFest. This was a recent change that it will now be virtual. I was hoping to be able to get out and about and see all of your faces and bump some elbows, but unfortunately, it will be virtual again this year. It was virtual last year as well. So I hope that if you participate, that you will still come to Washington Latin's private room and still chat with us and get more information or questions that you may have between now and then. And then on December 13th, you may apply. As Peter just said, you have to make sure that if you're applying for, because you can apply for our current campus, you can also apply for the Cooper campus, but you have to, one would be ranked number one or number two or whatever order you wish to rank them in, but you would have to apply to both. February 1 would be the deadline for high school, March 1 for middle school, then results released in April, and then you'll have until May 2nd to enroll. So this is all of our contact information. You might want to take a picture of that, a screenshot of that. We're also recording this. So if you want the recording, you can just let me know. We'll make sure you get that. But this is probably your first line of defense of anyone you might need to talk to get this ball rolling and to find out just more information. So it is time for questions. As you know, this is a webinar. So if you have any questions, please put them in the chat and we will read them aloud and we will answer them out loud.
Either in the chat or in the Q&A, you can use either. Thank you, Ms. Olivier. And I've noticed that there are some questions in the chat already that I can quickly answer. And I'll go in order of the way that I see them at the bottom of the chat list here. So the first question here that I see is, will you repeat how many total fifth and sixth grade spots we have at each school? For next year, we definitely have 95 spots in our fifth grade at the Second Street campus. We don't know if we will have any openings in sixth grade at the Second Street campus. That is not guaranteed. At the Cooper campus, we will have roughly 60. They're still, there's a possibility that it might be a little bit less, possibility it might be a little bit more. We're still working at some of those details. And then 95 sixth grade spots there. So between the two campuses, about 150 total fifth grade spots and at least 95 sixth grade spots. And then I'm just going to answer a couple more questions, and then I think, Mr. Kelly, there are a few here that you can respond to with regards to PE and homework loads, et cetera. I just want to quickly see others. What percentage of spots will go to siblings? So, you know, siblings, really, that's only applicable right now to the Second Street campus, because Cooper campus doesn't have any existing students to admit under sibling preference. But typically, in a typical year, and Ms. Elabella, correct me if I'm wrong, we have anywhere from 32 to, you know, 40 at most.
It's about a third of our applicants or students that we admit are siblings.
Right, for fifth grade. And so Yes. There will be, you know, plenty of spots left over between the two campuses after those slots have been claimed by siblings. Again, like I said, this is the best year to apply to fifth or sixth grade at Washington Latin, because you've got the most opportunities that you'll probably ever have to get into those grades. And then I noticed here that Mr. Kelly provided a response in the chat to a question about our college counseling program. I'll just tell you that one of the strongest facets of the Washington Latin program is our college counseling department. We have a director of college counseling who is not only outstanding and recognized as such by our own community, but plays a leading role in DC and plays a leading role in the country. She's actually sits on a number of bodies, a couple of boards and advisory groups, presents at national conferences quite regularly, and is highly regarded for her prowess. And we've got someone else on the team who comes out of a very successful career in college admissions, so knows what college is looking for, because she was one of the people accepting kids to college, who is now helping her kids to prepare for the application experience. So between the two of them, and the supports that they get from others, we've had a robust college counseling experience, and we've had students who've gone to a plethora of schools, small, large, not just in this country, believe it or not. We've had a number of kids who have been accepted to schools in Canada and in the UK and in China and Japan and Italy. There's been a wide catchment area. And then let's see if there are any other questions for me. And then just think the other questions I answered. Mr. Kelly, maybe you can jump on.
Sure. So I'll tackle the first question, which is the homework load. It's a question for ninth graders, but I'll share generally. As a rule of thumb, now there's variation here, and I just want to name that, especially depending on the kind of course load a student takes in the high school. But as a rule of thumb, if you take the grade that your student's in and multiply it by 10, that would be the ideal amount of homework that they're taking home every night. So a fifth grader is taking 50 minutes of homework home every night. The homework may look different in volume by class, by day. The classes do not meet each day. Each class meets 4 days a week on a rotating schedule, and that's true for both middle and the high school. But that's roughly our benchmark for what homework should look like. Now, in the high school, a student that's taking honors and AP classes, maybe bringing a heavier homework load home with them. And I'm sure Ella would attest to that, that it looks different at different points in time. We also have some elements in the high school to help students balance, like a study hall that students can take in the high school to balance their time out throughout the week. They also have the advantage of the fact that these classes do not meet every night, meet every day rather, so that they can space some of that homework throughout the week. There's another question here about how many times PE meets each week. So PE meets 3 times a week in grades 5 and 6. We offer PE in 5 and 6. Seventh graders and beyond, they are opting in for either team or non-competitive sports, and they commit to doing at least one season of sports, either fall, winter, or spring. The other note that I'll just make here, I did say this in the presentation earlier, but physical activity is really important for us, so recess every day throughout the week. I'm going to answer another question here about student support services. And then Mr. Anderson, there's questions about faculty moving back and forth between the two campuses, and I'll let you do that. But so are student support services available to students with IEPs and 504s? And yes, we are a public school. We honor all IEPs and 504s. We have a really tremendous student support services team with one case manager that works with every single grade, a dedicated case manager for each grade, a school psychologist. And in addition, we didn't mention this evening, but we have a very robust mental health counseling team with five full-time counselors on our faculty. All right, questions about eligibility for coming in based on Latin experience. No, unfortunately, if your student has learned Latin before they come here, that does not give them a leg up in the lottery, although that's awesome. And there was another question about just acclimating in general, if your student was not with us in middle school. So a student coming into the high school who was not with us in the middle school, they're not gonna be thrown into Latin 3, don't worry, in ninth grade. We'll begin the Latin sequence in ninth grade with Latin 1. We will determine your student's individualized schedule based on their background. So for example, many students come into ninth grade having already taken algebra at their school before coming to us. So we'll meet with each family in ninth grade and determine the appropriate placement for which courses they should go into based on the background that they have. Second language, Mr. Anderson, I'm gonna keep going and let you come back on in a few minutes if that's okay. So second language requirements, would you be able to continue Spanish in addition to Latin? We do not currently offer Spanish as one of our world language offerings. We do have several extracurricular activities, Spanish clubs in both the middle and the high school. And we have in the past offered a Spanish language class for heritage speakers. We also do allow for students to earn elective credit for coursework that they may do outside of school, and independent study credit for a student that wants to work on a project of their own. So we have honored and awarded credit for Spanish, but it is not a course that we offer at Washington Latin. How do we acclimate students who enter in sixth grade or later, particularly for Latin or overall? That looks different depending on the grade that the student's coming in. To be very candid, some years there's one student coming into a grade, and that may look different than when there's just, you know, 10 or 15 coming into the ninth grade. So how do we acclimate students? Well, first off, we anchor them with an adult. We're going to meet with your family before you come on campus if you're new to a grade outside of the fifth grade or the ninth grade, one-on-one to hear about the experience that they've had before coming to Latin, to set up some diagnostic testing if that's needed to help think through best placements and supports. And then we want them to be engaged. We're gonna connect you with their advisor right off the bat before the school year starts for a chance for you to share some background on your student and how they performed before coming to Latin. And then we're gonna work to help them link up with some buddies once they get to campus as well. So that acclimation looks different for each student. In fifth and ninth grade, we offer orientations for all of the students because we have larger student populations coming in at that time. And that is a pretty robust orientation that goes through acclimating to them to both their teachers, to their advisories, and to some of the support services that are available here at school. All right, intervention and on both campuses. Yes, we will provide intervention services. I can speak confidently to that piece, Mr. Anderson. We will honor the student support needs for students at both campuses. I think the last question I'll take, Mr. Anderson, before passing it back to you is what languages are offered outside of Latin? So starting in high school, students can enroll in a world language. We offer three world languages at Latin: Arabic, Chinese, and French. Chinese and French we offer through a terminal course in AP Chinese or AP French. There is no AP in Arabic, but we have an equivalent internally. We call it Advanced Arabic Seminar. We also offer Ancient Greek, as Mr. Anderson mentioned, for students who have advanced pretty significantly through their Latin sequence. So in addition to Latin, those are the other offerings that we have. All right, I'm gonna pass it over to you, Mr. Anderson. I think there are more questions coming in that are for me, but I'll let you take some of these questions about the Cooper campus.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly. So there was a question about legacy Second Street teachers moving over to the Cooper campus. And there'll be a very limited number of such transfers, as it were. One of the things that we have been doing is that we've hired a number of the Cooper campus staff who are with us this year, who are getting to learn our culture, getting to work with our current students and faculty, and will be prepared after a year here to be part of the new campus. And we're even open to continuing to do that, where in future years we may have some interns or fellows who spend a year here before they move on to the new campus. Let's see, what's the another question? There was a question about cross-campus sibling preference. If someone is accepted to, say, sixth grade at the Cooper campus, will a sibling have a preference at the Second Street campus? Unfortunately, that would not be the case. The sibling preference is not cross-campus. It's limited to the individual campus the student is a part of. So if there's a student who is a sixth grader with a sibling for a grade that is not currently offered at the Cooper campus, unfortunately, that student would not get a preference. One of the things that the city has been talking about and that we have been quite committed to is making an education at a school like Washington Latin accessible to students who may not otherwise have historically had access to our program. There is an equitable access preference that has been operationalized in DC that would allow students to have priority access to schools like ours, a certain number of seats. And so essentially the way that the lottery is going to work is that there will be a limited number of seats that will be designated for students who meet certain criteria. And we'll essentially have two lotteries. So we'll have a lottery for those students and accept students under that designated seat category first, and then we'll have the general lottery. But even with those two processes, there'll still be plenty of seats available in across the two campuses in fifth and sixth grade. So while I can't give you exact numbers right now, I can tell you that the expectation is that there will still be plenty of seats available on both campuses. And after 3 years beyond the sixth grade, so this is the idea. First year at the Cooper campus, we've got not a full fifth grade, but about, you know, 2/3 of a fifth grade, and then a full sixth grade. In the second year of that campus, we'll have a full seventh grade, a full sixth grade, and a full fifth grade. The third year at that campus, we'll have a full middle school with full grades in 5, 6, 7, and 8. And then in the fourth year, we'll be at another location where we'll add our high school. And so there will not be cross campus matriculation. We'll continue to build that Cooper campus until it has the same number of grades as the Second Street originally did. Didn't see if there were any additional questions that were.
There have been several questions, Mr. Anderson or Mrs. LBL, about the anticipated spots for ninth graders for next year.
So I'll take that one. So we typically take about 15 new ninth graders. And I always tell parents that that number, I know it sounds relatively small in comparison to the number of applications that we get, but ninth grade is always a strange year, because it's such a transitional year for all families and all students. So let's say we take 15 in the lottery. Out of that 15, maybe 10 say yes and 5 say no. I might go through another 10 to get that 5. So the point is, if you're on the wait list for ninth grade, I typically go through at least the top 30 to get that final 15. So, but it is usually around 15 new ninth graders.
And I see a question here about, will there be any outdoor space at the new campus? There will be some limited outdoor space. There is a park up the street that will also be available for students to use. And then we're also thinking about times when we might need a larger space for students. And so we are working on possibly transporting kids from time to time to other larger outdoor spaces. Unfortunately, there isn't as much outdoor space at that location as we have here at Second Street, but that is something that we will make the best use of. Yes, yes. And again, the Cooper campus is only limited for 3 years. It's only going to accommodate up to the middle school. We will not, we'll be moving to another campus, a campus that will be able to accommodate all grades 5 through 12, which will have, we anticipate more amenities and more resources and more supports once we're fully built out. Just like, you know, there was a time when before we moved into this building, when we had to split our school among multiple locations in order to be able to fit the full program while we were looking for a permanent home, which we eventually found here. And so something similar will be true for that Cooper campus. Question here, Ms. Alabiel, about shadow days. You're on mute.
So for shadow days, we are trying to figure out a way to do this safely. Ms. Fleming is typically on this call. She's our director of operations, and we've been having this discussion. So right now we are not prepared or ready to have students come from other schools to spend the day with a current student, but we are working out other ways we can do this. Like maybe we can set up something virtually where we can still have students meet and chat and at least get to know each other. I know it will be through a computer screen, but I will definitely be in touch with everyone. If you've been to an open house, you'll hear from me. If I've met you at a school fair, I know some of you are in the call today from, I met you last night at Two Rivers. So I will definitely be in touch when we come up with a safe solution for your students to meet our students and to see what a day in the life is in real life or via Zoom or something, but I will definitely be in touch.
Question here, thank you, Ms. Alabiel. Question here, would the Cooper campus have the same opportunities like main campus, theater, space, sports, et cetera? And we fully intend to have similar opportunities and programs available at the Cooper campus. There are gonna be some things that we can actually offer there that we may not be able to offer here, because we will actually have, in those first couple of years, some more space to be able to do some interesting things there that we might not be able to do here. And we invite families once the lottery is open and once we have an opportunity to do a tour, an open house at that campus, which wouldn't happen until February or March of next year to visit that space. And then there's a question about why Spanish is not a world language. It is a world language, it's just not a world language offered at Washington Land. And the reason for that actually goes back about 16 years, more than 16 years actually, when the charter for our school was written. And it was written by someone who preceded me, so I had nothing to do with it. And that charter reflected the languages that we teach now, that was written into our charter. And based on what was written into the charter, the school invested in the resources to build those programs. And it's not easy, one, to get the charter changed. That's one challenge. It's also not easy to phase out an existing program with students who are taking classes and faculty who are teaching those classes. And we don't have the resources to add something that's brand new in addition to what we currently have. Bear in mind that if you were going to offer another language, you'd have to think about all the levels of that language. And so you'd have to invest in not just one teacher, but multiple teachers over a number of years in order to be able to sustain that program and offer the full language experience that would be required. That said, it is possible, and I can't say for sure right now because it still has not been determined, but it is possible that Spanish could be a language offered at the Cooper campus. There is some flexibility that might allow for that on that campus. So while we might not have it here, we could potentially offer it there.
Mr. Anderson, I'm going to jump in with a question that was asked earlier about classroom management. And so I just want to ground us in a couple things. At Latin, we've said this several times, you'll hear it on and on because it's really who we are. We believe that words matter, ideas matter, and people matter. And so when it comes to classroom management, when it comes to raising young people and dealing with difficult moments, those are the things that guide us. So a couple of things I'd highlight. First, all of our teachers, we train our teachers to focus on the positive. We at Washington Latin, part of the way we develop culture is by celebrating the positive. This is gonna sound like a backwards answer, but I promise I'll get to classroom. We really highlight students that are doing the right thing. So we have monthly assemblies where we recognize students with merits for exemplary behavior, exemplary comportment, exemplary academic work in their respective spaces. We really try to focus and shine a light on things that are going well. When students make choices that are not the best, we will lean into those as teachable moments. We believe that at the root of discipline actually is the Greek word discipuli, which means student. It is a learning moment that happens when we have poor choices. And so we actually spend time with students. We have a team of deans of students. You saw one of them in the slideshow earlier, who work with students through those challenging moments, to help them to process. We're not the school that's just going to simply apply a consequence and keep moving. We sit with students, we help them to unpack what was the root cause of whatever they have done and to help think about how to make it better. We are guided in many ways by restorative justice philosophies. We also have a peer mediation program that is really well-developed in our school. Each semester, our director of conflict resolution trains a cohort of upper school students, and those students help to mediate disagreements that students may have with one another. We also offer to student disagreements with faculty the ability for them to sit down with Ms. Grant, who is our director of conflict resolution. So the focus here is the idea that these moments are learning moments, and we handle them accordingly. The next question is about how many seats do we expect to have in sixth grade at the Rudolph campus?
And very quickly.
Go ahead.
Go ahead, Ms. Elbit. I'm sorry.
Okay. So I'll just be very honest with you. Sixth grade is very difficult to get into because we typically only take the sibling to apply because we might have three or four spots for sixth grade, and we typically have about five siblings to apply. So not even all of the siblings get in. So the answer is probably about four or five spots for sixth grade. That's been the historical data.
And that obviously is at the Rudolph campus, but at the Cooper campus, there'll be 95 slots.
Yes.
Available. So at this point, I don't see any more questions either in the Q&A or in the chat. Is there anything else you wanted to speak to, Ms. Elabiel, before we wrap up the evening?
No, but just to say that, again, if you have any questions after you think of something after you log off that you wish you would have asked, please be in touch with me. You can call me, you can email me. We will, again, have a recording of this. If you missed, I saw somebody had a chat early on that she had to leave and pick up her boys. So I will definitely make this available to everyone who's here tonight. So if you have any questions, you have all of our contact information, and we really appreciate you coming out tonight.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Have a great night.
Thank you so much for being with us. Take care now.
Bye, Ella.